in Europe now. I'm staying in England. I've been there for 2 months, but I'd like to. I mean, I have a tendency to talk a lot, so I've been all over England, and I guess I'm not sure exactly how. How did you come to know? You know, people know people, and so here we are. Thank you. Alhamdulillah. So, the way that I like to talk is not really, I don't like to talk as much as I do. I like to listen and then start from there. So, call this a conversation and not a lecture or nasiha in that, you know, in that authoritative sense of the word, because, you know, that's for people who have reached the highest of levels, and we're just talking together. So I want to ask you, if someone was to ask you who it is that you are, how would you respond to that? Someone asks you, who are you? How would you respond? What would you say? How would you? Huh? What's your name?
Umair.
And you say Abdullah?
No, I would say actually I'm a Muslim.
You say you're Muslim?
Yeah.
All right. What else? What other response would you make?
I say I try to be a human.
A human. try to be.
As much as I can.
Yeah. May Allah help you.
I need all the help.
What other things would you say if someone asked you? Because the thing about being a Muslim is that it's true that, you know, a person, for example, I became a Muslim, but I wasn't Muslim in 1994. So that wouldn't be who I am, essentially. Who am I, essentially? Because if you define yourself by a religious affiliation, that's not always, you know, either when you become a Muslim, you don't become another individual. You know, you don't become like another person. There's not like another, there's not a clone or something like that that appears and, you know, the first one dies off. It's not like that. No, it's not. It's, you know, so I wasn't a Muslim in 1994, but I was in 1995, in late 95, November. So I don't know if that religious category would be a good definition of who I am. Well, for the sake of continuing the conversation, let's put that to the side. Then how else would you, define yourself?
Are you talking like saying that you're a creation, or are you talking about like more like are you talking about like feelings, or can you explain a little more?
I can't because it'll ruin the conversation. Oh, yeah. Who are you?
We all want to belong to a certain group: a Muslim, Algerian, Arab, Pakistani, I don't know. It's easy to claim belonging to a certain group.
Yeah, that's true. That's a social identity, but I'm talking about as an individual. That's true, but that's a social identity. My question is very specific.
Yeah, when you ask the particular question, who are you? You know, normally,
no.
I introduce myself by the name.
Okay.
So I'm not sure.
Okay, so let's say then you identify yourself by a name. Now, my name before I was a Muslim was not Abdul Latif, it's Lee. Right, my mom calls me Lee. Now, when I became Muslim, the idea was that I should have a Muslim name. I mean, now I don't think I would have done that, but I didn't know. You know? I mean, nothing wrong with Lee. It doesn't mean like it doesn't mean, you know, idol or worship this or that. You know, it doesn't have a bad connotation. But I just, you know, Abdul Latif is a nice name too, though. Alhamdulillah. But Lee, it was my name. Now, when I became a Muslim and I took on this name Abdul Latif, again, did I become a different person? In other words, when my mother sees me, since I changed my name, do I somehow become absent to her? In other words, if I came into the kitchen and said good morning to her, would she scream because I changed my name? Would she do that? No, because she's seeing the same person. She's seeing the same person. So I can't be my name either, because names can change, but something else stays the same. So I'm not my religious affiliation, per se. I'm not my name, per se. So what am I?
It's my experience. That's two dimensions of this. It's something okay. That ever changing my profession, my name, and my age, my location, and there's something that witnesses change.
Mm.
That's metaphysical.
Yeah, there's something constant.
Yeah, something's constant.
Right, so to kind of get rid of like all the fluff in the conversation, you're hitting exactly where we're going in this, that, you know, there are things about me that are changing. For example, and I can't identify with those things because they're changing, and you cannot be what is changing because what changes is not what is. It's continually on its way out. So, for example, my body, some people would have said, well, I'm my body. And that's how we ruin young women in our societies, by making them identify with their bodies, right? Sell them products to make them feel, first of all, make them, I don't know how it is here, but in America, make them feel insecure about themselves. Make them feel like they have to be one certain body type, and then sell them products that will make them look like the airbrushed image on the, you know, on the internet or whatever the case may be. But the thing is that I can't identify with my body because my body is always changing. Like, I wasn't born this big. You know, my mother still recognizes me, even though I wasn't born this big, right? And also, as I get older, you know, this dark hair is going to turn white, right? It's going to change color. I'm going to sag more. I might lose teeth. My physical form is going to change. My physical form is going to continue to change. So, a photograph you saw of me 3 years ago might not be identical to what you're seeing now. So, does that make me a different person?
No.
So I cannot be my body, even though my body has changed. So therefore, I cannot say that I am a religious affiliation per se. I can't say that I'm a social identity per se. I can't say that I am a name, and I can't say that I'm a body. Okay, well then, the human condition is creative, is based on three things. I mean, in terms of Western ideas, which is where we are, you have mind, body, and soul. Well, the thing that's left is my mind, so I must be my mind. Right? I must be my mind. Well, the thing is that my mind changes every day. I don't think about like the same things I thought about yesterday. Because, for example, when we got off the plane, I was concerned about getting something done. That's not my concern anymore. My thoughts are not in that anymore. Right? So you couldn't identify with me as, oh, that's Abdul Latif, the guy who wants to get his scan done. Right? Because I'm not that person. I was... But now that's, you know, that's not essential to me. Again, it's passing. All right. So I'm not my religious affiliation. I'm not a social identity per se. I'm not my name per se. I'm not my body per se. And I'm not my mind per se. Well, that only leaves us one thing. A person is basically composed of three parts. In terms of, you can say, I don't like to use the word. I don't like the word Islamic because it has funny connotations. But Muslim metaphysics, you can say there's basically one part that's missing we haven't discussed yet, and that's the soul. Now, the soul, what we do know about it is that when you don't have one anymore, it's pretty obvious. When you don't have a soul anymore, it's pretty obvious your body rots, and you know. The thing is that you might love someone, you've been in their house for 35 years, 40 years, your wife and you've been sharing the same house, and you've had children together, and you grew up in this house, and you know, that's where this happened, and that's where that happened, all the memories are there. But as soon as the person dies, their soul leaves that body, what do they want to do with the body?
Bury.
Get rid of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's true. It's like we love you, man, but you gotta go. You know, so there's no attachment per se to, and we know this intrinsically. There's no attachment per se to the body itself, even though in the world we must take care of our bodies. But the way that we, as Western people, obsess over physicality and over material, it's destroyed by the fact that when people die, the last thing we want to do is consider, you know, what they're gonna wear the next day. So the last thing we're concerned about, we want to get rid of the body. Because that person, and that body doesn't mean anything to us. I mean, it means enough to where we have respect for it, for being the vessel that that person was in. But not being that person himself.
Mm-hmm.
Right? In other words, if you've ever seen a dead person or ever touched their face, it's like there's nothing happening there. It's just a pile of flesh. So, well, therefore... If someone asked me who you are, you'd have to say, I am my soul. Now, what's very interesting about that is that when you look in the Quran and you look at the way that God addresses us, you find interesting ayat. One of them being when Allah said, He narrates to us, "Qala alastu bi rabbikum." He said, "Am I not your Lord?" "Qalu bala." They said, "Indeed." When Allah showed Himself to the arwah, to the souls, He showed Himself to the arwah and He asked them, "Am I not your Lord?" And the souls responded, "Indeed." Now, saying indeed is different than saying yes. Indeed is different than yes. Number one, because if you say, "Am I not?" and you say yes, then you're saying you are not. Sure, that's language. But there's something more about that. That when you say bala, when you say indeed, you're testifying to something. So for example, if someone asked me, "Do you like Swiss chocolate?" And I go, "Indeed." That's different than saying yes, isn't it?
Yeah, sure.
What's the difference?
You're showing passion.
Yeah, because it's an experience that I had. It's an experience that I had. The experience caused me to be entranced. I had delight over that thing. It delighted my soul. And that's what beauty is, that which delights the soul. That which delights the soul is that which fulfills the soul. So when Allah presented Himself before us and He asked us, "Am I not your Lord?" Notice the way that we responded, we said indeed. We didn't say yes, which means we had an experience. Now here's the question. How can we bear witness to experience and have a witnessing of something? We didn't have a brain, we didn't have eyes, we didn't have any of the hawas al-khams, the five senses. We didn't have the five senses which we depend upon so much in this world, and which we literally make into gods. Whatever appeals to these five senses is true, and whatever does not is not true. Yeah. Especially in the Western countries, we really do this a lot. But what's funny about that is that we depend so much upon sensory truths. But isn't it that not so long ago that we used to think that the sun used to rise and set? And you ask somebody, you know, a pre-modern individual about that, they'd swear by their life the sun rises and sets. They'd say, "Look, you idiot, like, use these. Do you see? The sun is setting, it's not there anymore." And they would swear by, they would go to war over it.
Yeah.
But look, we found out, it's not that the sun is moving, we're going around the sun. We're rotating as we go around the sun. We're spinning as we're spinning. So it's an optical illusion. The senses were wrong. And if the senses can be wrong in that, can the senses be wrong in other things too? But the soul can't be wrong. The soul can't be wrong. Because the soul is not based in... it's not a sensory instrument that is based upon the unqualifiable... quantifiable objects. In other words, the soul knows. How? Well, the Quran tells us again. Didn't Allah say, "Fadhkuruni adhkurkum"? Remember me and I'll remember you. How are you supposed to remember something that you never even experienced? How are you supposed to remember something you never experienced? Remember when all of us, we went to Stockholm together that one time? Remember that time we went together in the bus? Remember? Remember when you got sick and we had to pull over on the side of the road? Remember that? Remember? Remember? Now look, now I'm commanding you. Remember. Udkur. Remember. That would be oppressive on my side because you can't remember something, you cannot recall something that didn't happen to you. If Allah said, "Remember me," he can't ask us to remember something that we don't already know. It's not possible. Now, on another level, because I don't like to step into like the religious box as much as I like to step outside of it. What I mean by that is that we have made a box that we call religion, which is a kind of a dichotomy with the world that we're living in. Which is unfortunate because that's not really the message of the Quran. The Allah says, "Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen." All praise is due to Allah, Lord of the worlds. There's a big difference between a world and an earth. Have you thought about that?
Yeah.
What's the difference between a world and an earth?
I mean, I guess there are worlds within, I mean, on Earth, I mean, that's allowed.
But what's a world, though? What's an Earth and what's a world? Allah says Ard and He says Alam. He uses two different words. He didn't say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Aradin. All praises due to Allah, Lord of the Earths.
The one is inside the other.
It is, but how?
A different dimensions, right?
How, though? Where does the world exist?
You experience different.
The world exists in you.
Yeah.
Without human beings, there wouldn't be worlds. Because the world is what's the interpretation of your experience in the earth. That's called a world. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. It's something that is based on the experience of a sentient being. That's called a world versus an earth. How are you supposed to praise the Lord of the worlds if you're not even living in the world? How? You can't. You can praise the Lord of the earth if you're just living on the earth. But if you're not living in the world, how can you praise the Lord of the worlds? How can you know Him? What we've done is that we have a tendency to just kind of, you know, we have a dichotomy between this and that. This is what we tend to do. Now, I was saying that as a context to kind of go forward and say, in the world itself, or in the earth itself, this is an earth proposition, not a world proposition. Depending if you're one of those kinds of people, it's your world. But in the earth, this is happening. Look, didn't Allah say, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ? Did He say that, yes or no? Of course He said that. Now, if Allah doesn't remember me, what will happen to me?
I'll be lost.
No, a loss is not even close to what will happen. I'll be lost, all right, but in a way that... If Allah ceases to remember me, what will happen? Worse. No, not really. I will disappear. I will disappear. You will not. There will be this thing called Abdul Latif won't even be in your heads. You know, it'd be like the Atlantis. You know, like, yeah, I think there was something, but we can't find traces of it. It's gone. It's out of remembrance. It's as if Allah Himself forgot about that thing. So if Allah stops remembering me, I will cease to exist. So it's through His remembrance of me that I even exist. His recollection of me that I even exist. Now, is it because I'm a Muslim that's the truth? Is it because of I say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah that this is the case? Is that why? No. It's because I am his creature from creation. That's why that's the case. Now, wait a minute. This microphone, does it exist, yes or not?
Yes.
Yes. Does this microphone mention Allah's name? It has to. In its own way. It's tasbih. It has its own tasbih. If it didn't, it would not be... In other words, God has to remember it first. If He didn't remember it, it wouldn't exist. It's making tasbih. It's involuntary because it doesn't have any volition. Well, what about people who are atheists? Allah said, remember me and I remember you. If Allah doesn't remember you, you cease to exist. What about people who disbelieve in God entirely? Do they make dhikr of Allah too? The answer, it has to be yes. But it's their cells are making dhikr. Their cells are making dhikr. Their limbs are making, their eyes are making dhikr. Their ears are making dhikr. The only thing, as a matter of fact, they are a walking contradiction. The only thing that's not making dhikr of them is their own will. That's why when you come into Islam, you submit your will. Because you're saying, oh Allah, I'm not going to go against the fabric of reality. I get it. I'm not going to go against the fabric of reality. I get it. I'm going to do like everything else is doing. I'm going to submit. That's what makes me different than Shaitan. The Adamic model is that you submit. And the Shaitanic model is that you refuse. You refuse reality itself. So, the import, yeah, go ahead.
So you mean that even though a person is an atheist, the limbs will always do the dhikr of Allah?
They have to.
So you are basically doing some kind of zulm on the limbs if you don't do zikr.
You're doing zulm on your soul. And that's why we're saying. The soul, that's the next step of the conversation. The soul is the most important part of you because it's who you actually are. You can lose a limb. May Allah save us. You can lose a limb, but you're still going to be you. But it's the soul that is wronged. It's the soul that becomes wronged. You know, in Ramadan, for example, how long do you guys fast here in Ramadan? The hours?
20 somewhere, I think.
Right?
Not here.
Tabarakallah. 19
here. Are you serious?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
MashaAllah, Mujahideen. Are you serious? That's 4 hours of just like, get it in.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Wow. Jihad affair.
Yeah, MashaAllah. Ashar, if you ever want me to come, just not in Ramadan, inshallah. Yeah. Okay, but you know, one sister, she said it, you know, Australian sister, she said a beautiful statement about this. And she said that, you know, I now understand what my soul is going through every day of the year outside of the month of Ramadan by how my body feels right now. So there is food for the body, which we all know very well, and we have preferences. And there is food for the soul, which the vast majority of people don't know. So people are walking around hungry. They're fasting. Their souls are fasting. But the problem is, with like the body, that if you don't feed the soul, it eventually dies. Especially if the intake that it has is harmful to it. In other words, if we didn't eat food, but then we started eating charcoal. Charcoal is actually kind of good for you, in your stomach. But if you just eat pounds and pounds of it, what's going to happen to you? You're going to die. So likewise, if the soul takes in those things which are other than Allah, the soul takes in other than Allah all the time, all the time, all the time, all the time, it literally dies, because its food is Allah. It's food. There's no difference between the name and the named. Right? Like if you were to close your eyes and I was to say, no, you don't have to do that. Watch. Onion. What do you see in your head?
Tears.
All right, let's try again. Microphone. We can do it all day long. I can run your life by just saying these words. I control everything in your head, because you cannot... There's an association between the name and the named. You say something, you see the image, you cannot stop that. There's no difference between the name and the named. But isn't it beautiful that when it comes to Allah, His name has no image? But our heart remembers. Hey, there's no difference between the name and the named. So the heart, how the soul gets food, which is who you are, how you get food is through the mention of your Lord's name. Because it's through the mention of the Lord's name that the soul is delighted. Allah bidikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. Is it not but through the remembrance of Allah that the hearts feel tranquility? This is how the hearts are, how the soul is fed.
But what is the difference between the soul and the nafs?
So you have, imagine now, you have this thing called ruh. وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. And we breathe into him from this soul that we own. Right? That at that point, you are your ruh, and you came from the alam al-arwah. Now, after that point, Allah prepared a vessel for you in the world of means. In the world of means, your jism, Allah, or your body, your bedin, Allah put the soul was put into the body. When the soul goes into the body, the relationship between the ruh and the jism, between the soul and the body, that relationship is called nafs. Mm-hmm. Now that nafs, it starts off disobeying Allah. Nafs al-amara bis-su, as Allah mentions in the Quran. The nafs which is commands towards evil. Thank you. But then if Allah shines light on that soul, if Allah wants good for that soul will begin to remember Allah. And then when that happens, it will struggle. It will have what's called taqallub. Taqallub is like taraddud. It's going back and forth. Qalaba means to flip. Taqallub is flipping. It's flipping. The heart sometimes, the nafs, this entity that you are, your ruh or your nafs, it's sometimes going towards Allah, and sometimes it's going back towards the world, its experience in the world. Sometimes it's going towards Allah, sometimes it's going back to the world of means. That is called taqallub. That stage you are now called a qalb. And then if Allah inspires that heart more, that qalb more, and they work on remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah transforms that ruh into what's called an aqal. This is true intelligence. Intelligence is not one and one is two. Intelligence is that you realize. Example: why is intelligence is a funny thing? The rational intelligence, the way that we look at it, is funny. If I was to ask you what 1 + 0 is, what would you say? 1. If I asked you what 1 + 1 is, what would you say? Isn't 0 a digit? Is 0 a digit? Is the absence of a digit? It's the absence of a digit, but in being so, it's still a digit. Because if you add it after a one, it becomes 10. You add it after, you get two of them, it becomes 100. Now, again, I asked you, what is 1 + 0? You told me it's 1. What if I told you 1 + 0 is 2? Aren't there two entities there? Look, this is 1. This is 0. Are there two entities here?
Sure.
There are two things. Okay, so 1 + 0 has to be 2. You follow me?
Yeah.
The mind is very finicky. The mind is weak like that. But that's when we say aql, when we say rational, that when we say aql, people translate that as your intellect, you know, the rational part of the soul and all that. That's not what it means. It's the aql is that thing which has perceived the light of God. And it understands things by virtue of, like, if you were to turn all the lights off right now, that's the absence of an aql. If you turn the lights back on again, that's the presence of an aql. It has the light of God shining in it. It's able to understand the nature of things, how things actually are. That's called an aql. And then if that ruh, which became a nafs, and then became a qalb, and then became an aql, if it continues forward, it returns, it actually claims it's the prize that's in itself, which is called a sir. Sir means a secret. There's something inside you and I that's so valuable that Allah created us. That's that reason why He created us, that secret between us and Him, in Arabic it's called sir. That the purpose of us coming into the earth and being in the world, whatever our world is to realize the secret that we have. The same reason why Adam was sent into the earth. Was Adam a Nabi in Jannah? It's not a trick question. was he a Nabi in paradise? Was Adam a Nabi in paradise?
Yeah.
No. Wallahi, he wasn't. No. He was not a Nabi in paradise. When Allah put him into the earth, He gave him Nubuwwah. He had to call his family. Before that, he didn't have a nubuwa. He had to real. He became. Was Adam a khalifa in paradise? Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. I'm gonna put a khalifa in the earth. He didn't say he's gonna put a khalifa in paradise. He didn't have his rank. He had nothing in paradise. He was just in paradise, hanging out. There's a tree. Don't eat from it. Things went the wrong way, but it wasn't the wrong way at all. It was actually exactly how Allah said, I'm going to create a khalifa in the earth. Allah told them what was going to happen before it even happened. It looked bad. It looked real bad. but when Allah put him in the earth, everything was good. In other words, Allahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamun.
Yeah, but doesn't that make him a Nabi? Because that's what it became. So he must have been at that moment as well. Mm. But he just didn't know. He never knew.
And Allah's knowledge, he was a Nabi.
Yeah.
Sure. And Allah's knowledge, he's a Nabi.
That's what I was thinking.
Oh, absolutely. But on the, but as far as he knew, he's just, I'm the one.
No.
Huh?
I made it.
Yeah.
but the word aql, the Arabs, so you mean they have, this word has not been treated right?
No, the way that Western people deal with the word aql, we go towards rationalism, and rationalism is not what is meant by the aql, and there is an aspect of that to the aql, but it's not. So, example, an iqal, you know, the Khaliji Arab, they wear the iqal. The iqal is that thing that you wrap around your head. You know why you wrap it around your head? Because when they used to ride camels. When they would tie it, they take that thing off their head and tie the camel. And then when they're done, they put it back. They're so close to those times, they still wear that because it's traditional that they have a rope over their heads. That's why it's called iqal. But an iqal is what bounds you. Now, why does it bounds you from what and how? The aql is what keeps you bound to God. It's what keeps you bound to the truth, the aql, because you know better. But the way that, you know, the rational 1 plus 1 is 2, that's a Western understanding of, in other words, it's a completely lateral understanding of being bound. That you're bound laterally. There's certain rules and forces in the earth that we have to understand, right? But the thing is that our senses are messed up. You know, we talked about the sun setting. To me, it's one of the best examples of like, ah, man, that sucks. I wonder what else we're wrong about. But there's a lateral understanding too. A vertical understanding. That's the aql has a vertical. Because of the vertical, you begin to understand the lateral. That's why Allah mentioned in the Quran so many times about, you know, the idea that the Muslim, you know, should look in the signs of the earth. Like Allah said, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْأَفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. We're going to show them our signs in the horizon and themselves until it becomes clear to them that verily He is the truth. That He said, I'm going to show them my signs in the horizons. The aql is going to go up first. It's going to go up, and then once it realizes, in other words, like, for example, we make dua like this because this is the qibla of dua. Likewise, celestial understandings are beyond created understandings. That's, you know, that's how we kind of think about things. So when we look up, in other words, when we're looking up, we're looking past the created realm as far as we understand it. And so the first thing Allah says is that we're going to show them our signs in the horizon, in other words, in the vertical. And in themselves, which is now in the lateral, until it becomes clear to them that verily He's the truth. How that's possible is the aql. The aql is that ruh that has reached that stage of understanding.
So how do you know, you see that the goal is to reach that kind of aql? How do you reach that?
This is through the remembrance of Allah. Because it's through the remembrance of Allah that you reach that. How? Because when the soul is placed into the body, a darkness overcomes it. The darkness of otherness, the darkness of the world of means overcomes it. It's veiled now. And when it was before it came to this world, it was in Allah's presence. But when it comes into the world, it's veiled by asbab, by the means. In other words, I'll give you an example. This microphone is recording my voice into a device, which will probably be downloaded into some kind of computer, which will then be broadcast all over, who knows where. Right? Now, this mechanism is taking my voice into it, and it does whatever it does to save my voice, and then reproduce it in another place. Okay, now the thing is that, do you believe that this device has the power to do that itself? Or is it something that Allah puts into the device? Well, okay, make a simpler example. This is water, I believe. All right, so this is water. Now, when you're thirsty, what do you normally need to do?
Drink it.
Thank you. this is the world of means. So normally you drink, when you have of something, you have to go to something. It's the world of means. Dar al-asbab. Okay, now this is water. Now generally, like and Allah said in the Quran, لَن تَجِدُوا فِي سُنَّةِ اللَّهِ تَدِيلًا, that you're not going to find a change in the sunnah of Allah. Right? In other words, you're going to find that things are the way that they stay on a certain course, usually. It's only when those things are broken that we realize, oh my God, you know, خَرْقُ الْعَادَةِ, you know, that these are called miracles. Something happens, it's abnormal, and then you realize, oh my God, God can do what He wants. Right? So, for example, Moses goes to the Red Sea and it parts. That's not normal. He was told to put a stick in the water. A piece of wood in the water, and it becomes, you know, okay. So anyway, this glass here, it has water inside of it, and usually when a person is thirsty, they're going to drink water. They're not going to eat. They're not going to eat a pile of bricks. No, unless they're Majnoon, they're not going to do that. Okay, now if I go and as believers, we do know that this water has no qualities of its own. That's why Allah told the fire to be cold for Abraham. If the fire was intrinsically hot, then it would have said, Allah, I can't do that, I'm sorry, you know what I do. But what's more interesting is that, listen, the fire heard God. Remember I said that these inanimate objects, do you think that they have anything going on? The fire heard God and responded, did exactly what it was told to do. Now, in other words, it's the slave of Allah. So this water here, it doesn't have any ability of its own. If I drink it, bismillah. If I feel any quenching in my throat, and if I feel satiated, it's because Allah gave that water the command to do so. It's possible, quite possible, that I would, if I drink that it would actually burn my lips, even though it's liquid. Allah can do that. And there's even an angel that sits at your throat. For every morsel of food that you eat, there's an angel that sits there. And it asks Allah, "Oh Allah, is this to be beneficial for this person or is it to be harmful?" You find this in the hadith. So, then we can say on a metaphorical level that when I am going to drink this glass of water and when I'm going to put it to my lips, this is called isti'ana. This is actually I'm asking Allah for help. How is that? Because when I'm reaching for this cup of water and I'm going to put it to my lips, in reality, who is it that I'm reaching for? It's Allah. No, Allah is not a cup. But you're calling, your actions are a call, nida. And you're saying, "Oh Allah, give me, quench my thirst." And if Allah wants to, He'll put that inside. Now, is that because I'm a Muslim? No. Is that because I have done a little bit of studying? No. That's the reality of the world that we live in, and it's true about every single act that we do. Everyone's calling on God continually. It's impossible for it to be any other way.
Wait, can I ask you something?
Yeah.
The symbols, like Buddha symbols and Christian symbols.
Yeah.
They have to call in God every kind of example now. Huh. Yeah, if they don't, that doesn't exist. That was you telling me.
I don't think I understand. تكلم عن العربي.
العربي. كيف بدأ لك بالعربي يعني.
على سبيل المثال مثلا عندك.
I think what he's trying to say is that if these. Like you have the Christian symbol, you have the Buddhist symbol. Now these are being worshipped, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
What the thing is, are these also calling to Allah?
No, but wait. I said, let's step out of the religious box for a moment.
Ah, okay.
We're just talking about, now we're talking about reality.
Yeah, reality.
Not.
Yeah, yeah.
We're not talking about worlds now.
Yeah, no.
Anyway, remember the difference between earth and...
But how is it in this area?
Yeah, in those areas, the thing is, it's the same way as this is batil.
Yes.
This cannot help me. This is the same as an idol. It's the same as a Buddhist symbol or a Confucius symbol. They're all lifeless. Cannot help me. لا فائدة فيه. There's no benefit in them whatsoever. على الإطلاق. But still, people have to use things. But Allah gives the benefit in the usage. Because they can't help themselves even.
No.
Anyway. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Now the Muslim is aware of إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ in a way that the others just are not aware of, or they've forgotten. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ is actually everything in creation, because who else are you going to worship? And who else are you going to be able to call? Who else is there to worship and who else is there to be called on? The Muslim is simply, that's the grace of Allah. ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُطِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That's the grace of Allah, He gives to whomever He wants to give, that you actually wake up. That's called an aql. That's called intelligence, that you actually realize what is going on.
So what you're basically saying, as I understand it, is everything around us is actually confirming Allah.
Absolutely.
Because it wouldn't be there if Allah wouldn't allow it.
Absolutely.
And Allah is the curator of everything, so...
Yes.
So whether it be something bad or good,
absolutely,
it's still a confirmation of
absolutely of God's presence. Now the thing is that you almost hit with my point, and ultimately, and that's to say that everything is actually making dhikr. Mm-hmm. Everything is making dhikr except for me, consciously. I'm the one who's outside of. I'm the one who's lost. But that's the amana that Allah put onto us. That's the trust that Allah put onto us. That's the problem that we have, is that we are the ones who are cognizant of what's happening. We make the world. What is just an earth has become a world through us. Because we're interpreting God's science. We're interpreting things. We're making worlds. by virtue of the human being. Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. It's very deep, very beautiful actually. And it makes you realize, like, my God, what happened to us? Human beings are, we're, if we don't, this is all because of Rasulullah s.a.w. All of it. He, if, without him, how would we, how? How would we know any of this stuff? So, in the end, if this is a nasiha, then I would say that my advice for everyone is that understand that if you have some kind of spiritual path and you're making dhikr, that's good. If you don't have a spiritual path and you're not making some kind of official type of dhikr, that doesn't mean that you can't make dhikr. But really, those two things are not nearly as important as why am I making dhikr? Why? Why do it in the first place? Is it because my ancestors did it? That's not the right answer. Is it because, you know, I like the brothers, when we're done, we eat good food? That's not a good, that's not a great answer. It's understandable, but it's not a great answer. No, the reason why we make dhikr is so that we can actually fulfill the commandment of Allah. It's that we worship Allah in a way that pleases Him, not in a way that pleases us. نَعْبُدُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ يَرْضَى لَيْسَ مِنْ حَيْثُ نَرْضَى. That we worship Allah Ta'ala in a way that makes Him happy, not in a way that makes us happy. Now, I want to give you examples. What is the purpose of Salat? Salat is that thing that Allah is going to ask us about first in paradise. What is the purpose of Salat?
It's for our sake.
Mm-mm. What does the Quran say?
For God's sake.
Yeah, but what's the Quran say? Yes.
لِذِكْرِ
أيوه. وَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِ طَاهَا. It's in طَاهَا. Establish the prayer for my remembrance. If Salah is the most valuable thing that we have to be asked about on the Day of Judgment, and its purpose is to establish the remembrance of Allah, that's why Allah said, وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرُ. And the remembrance of Allah is the greatest thing. But the question though is, what is dhikr? What is it?
Is it like maintenance?
Maintenance? Yani. Yani. But there's something where I'm not hitting it on the head. Go in. What is dhikr? Everybody likes dhikr, but what is it?
It's food for the soul.
Yeah, but what is its reality? What's the reality of dhikr? What happens when you, what is this, what is needed in it for it to be truly dhikr? Yeah.
Sincerity.
There's a quality. Now we're getting somewhere. There's a, it's a quality.
Eh? Binding.
Niyya.
It's an experience. It's an experience that happens. That it's the zenith of dhikr.
Practice. No.
The feeling.
The reality of dhikr is that you forget everything but the madhkur. The reality of dhikr is that you forget everything but the one being remembered. That's the reality of dhikr. That you forget everything but the one being mentioned. Outside of that, you're not remembering them. Dhikr is that you are in a state that the only thing that you're experiencing is the one being mentioned. And so that is true dhikr. And that's when Allah said, وَقِيمَ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, and established the prayer for my remembrance. That's what remembrance He's talking about. The reason why you and I do dhikr is because you and I are trying to realize states of remembrance. That we get to a point where we have realized the reality of dhikr. In other words, we have a vision, an experience of God that is reinstated from what we knew before we came here. You remember yourself. As your remembrance is as yourself was before you came here. Now there's some people, they like the world. Have you ever seen The Matrix?
Yeah.
You remember The Matrix? Remember the guy, the part when the guy's eating the meat? The Matrix, the first one. And he knows it's a matrix. He knows it's all a lie. But he's like, but he loves the meat. Remember that part? Okay, there's some people that are kind of like that even though they know this is not really the real thing, they like it. So they'll forfeit their future because they want to experience what they can have right now.
Ignorance is bliss.
ignorance is bliss in that way. Ignorance is bliss until you realize you're ignorant. Right? Ignorance is bliss until you realize you're ignorant, and then it's hell.
But that person you explained about that, does he have aql?
No, that still person is pure nafs.
It's just nafs and ear, just going...
It feels good, man. Give me some meat.
Yeah.
Fake meat.
Because a person who have experienced aql, like you explained, he will never go back.
No. No, because they want good for themselves. So the thing is that there are some people that are living in this world that are even lower than that person in the matrix, where that they don't think about whether or not in other words, God is showing them death every single day. Every single day death comes and they see it every single day. But every time someone dies, they're surprised. You know, oh, your friend died. Ah, how do you of course they're gonna die. Why are you like that? You know what I mean? Like, they act like, how can this happen? How can it be? And you're like, dude, how many people that you love have to die before you accept the fact this is coming to you too? You know? Remember your goldfish died when you were a kid? Remember that? Remember the goldfish? Remember your aunt, your favorite aunt? Remember those people? Like, it's you too, man. It's coming. But there are people that are in such denial of the truth. That's called kufr. They're in denial of the truth that they'll eat that. They just want to eat the meat. And they want to hold on to the last moment. Those kinds of people, they don't want to remember. And they don't make remembrance. On the other side of that, you have individuals that they cannot wait to get home again. They can't wait to get... These are called Ahlullah, the people of Allah. The people of Allah, they love to meet Allah, and Allah loves to meet them. And that's why he said, أَنَا جَلِيسُ مَنْ ذَكَرَنِي أَنَا جَلِيسُ مَنْ ذَكَرَنِي I am the sitting companion of the one who remembers me. إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي فِي نَفْسِهِ ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي نَفْسِي If he mentions me in his heart, I mention him in my heart. إِذَا ذَكَرَنِي فِي مَلَئٍ If he mentions me in a gathering, ذَكَرْتُهُ فِي مَلَئٍ أَعْلَى أَوْ خَيْرًا مِنْهُ If he remembers me in a gathering, I remember him in a gathering better than it. There are some individuals that they are running home. They're running to Allah. They miss home. And for them, home isn't paradise. Because for them, home is not paradise, because they realize that paradise is just another creation. They've already had their fill of that here in this world. They want the creator of creation. That's the only thing that will make their heart satisfied. These are Ahlullah, the people of remembrance, true remembrance. They're not satisfied with, you know, tents, houses made of pearl that are 60 miles long. They're like, man, what's that going to do me if I don't have Allah? You know, there are some people that they're so in love with God. They have a primordial love, an attachment with God, that they're the ones that are either striving for or have achieved that dhikr, which causes them to forget everything that's not Him. Because that's all they want is Him, right? And these are the people of what's called ma'rifah, people of knowing, people who know the truth. All of this is based upon a pull that's in your heart. Something pulls you. Something pulls. May Allah make us pulled. What is that thing that's... What do you think it is? What's that thing that pulls you like that? What do you think that might be?
Allah's love for you.
Or just Allah. Allah Himself. You can't... How can you say Allah and him, without Him saying your name first? How can you mention Allah without Him mentioning you first? As soon as you feel that pull towards Allah, it's because Allah wants you first. So if you're making the dhikr of Allah, it's because Allah wants you. But do you think Allah is going to satisfy Him? Do you think Allah is going to be satisfied that you mention Him and other things? Nah. He'll pull more and pull some more. If He loves you, pull some more. And if He loves you, He'll give you problems. Right, you find it in a hadith in the Muwatta of Imam Malik that when Allah loves a slave, He gives him problems. Why? Because He wants him to see that this thing is not what you want. He removes this from that slave. He removes that from that slave. Look at the prophets; all of them were tried. All the awliya were tried. Look at them all, with exception, but few. What are the signs of my drawing close to Allah? That I'm stepping forward and problems start to come. I have to make decisions in my life. Either I'm gonna, for example, you start to pray Salat. Let's say you might be selling alcohol at the moment, and you start praying Salat, and then you're like, But you're like, but I just love that the Taraweeh prayer in Ramadan. Like, it just, it reminded me of something I forgot. But you're, you know, but alcohol is happening. And so what do you, and you're like, oh, I have a mortgage to pay. Oh, my kids are in college. If I don't sell this alcohol, oh God, but I just want Allah. Okay, so what happens? That person makes mujahada and they struggle. They get rid of it. At first, they start to, they feel the weight of the decision. Boom, it hits them. Then they start to have doubts. Oh, did I do the right thing? Maybe I should have, maybe I'm being an extremist. Right? But they move forward and then Allah gives them something better. Allah gives them something better. First, it starts in their hearts. And if He wants to, He'll give them something better outwardly. Then that individual, he's coming to the masjid. He's not selling haram anymore. But it's like he has this girlfriend, kind of. You know, and she's like, she's really beautiful and really young, and he can't even believe that she's around him, and you know, he worked so hard to get her, and she hates.
What about kids who were in college?
Yeah, well, that was the
first marriage.
Yes, first marriage. That's the first marriage. That ended a long time. That ended when he started selling his stuff. He lost everything. So there's no barakah, right? So then he gets like a pretty young thing, you know, but she hates religion. And she's just foul-mouthed, and like there's no hair in her. She's just all outward. And he's like, and that dhikr that he does at the goes to the gatherings, and the dhikr he does in the masjid, and you know the reading of Quran that he does. It just every time he goes home, it's ruined. And she's become the ugliest thing to him, but he still loves her. His nafs loves her. So what's he start thinking about? He's like, I can't let this be an obstacle. Look, either you're gonna have to marry me, or you gotta go. And she's like, marry you? You mean I gotta do this for life? Oh man. The next thing you know, he sees the reality of the situation. He happened to be making a lot of money, and she's just around because he's making that money. And ever since his money started going down, you know, he's not selling alcohol and all that kind of stuff anymore, now she's starting to consider the relationship differently. So he kicks her out. Sure, he's sad. He misses her, but then what happens? Levels. Allah is removing things from him because Allah wants him for himself.
But what if he failed? Does he
go no, if, level? That's called the qalb. Remember I said the qalb. I'm telling you the stages of what happens. When he first started out, he was just a nafs. He was just a nafs, man. He was selling alcohol, hanging out in the clubs, you know, with this pretty young thing. Right? He was just a nafs. But then he went, you know, something happened. Allah gave him tawfiq. He went to the Taraweeh prayer. And I don't know what it was, the imam or something happened. And he's just like, he came home, some light came on. So now he's a qalb. He's fighting. He's not going to pass every test, but he's fighting. So then he goes up and now he has intelligence. Allah shows him that this woman, he starts to understand what's really happening. He's like, man, this woman doesn't even, I love her. And she doesn't even like, I don't even think she knows like, I don't even, you know what I mean? She doesn't know my mom's name, doesn't know my dad's name, she doesn't know my kid's name. Wait a minute. She doesn't even know me. Wait a minute. He starts, the light comes on. He realizes what's really happening. That's because he has an aqab. And he realizes that she actually is, she is a walking eraser. She erases all the khair in his life. Even though she sure is fine. That's good looking for an American.
Yeah.
So anyway, he goes up the aqal. Now he goes up more, right? And then he's continuing. Then he gets to people. He gets amongst Ahlullah. Now because of his struggling, now he's ready. Allah introduces him to one of his friends, right? Now Allah brings him close to one of his friends, and now he sees an inheritor of the Prophet ﷺ. In other words, now you've been cleaned up enough to be amongst those people, so you can be. What did the Prophet say, peace be upon him? Al mar'u ma'a man ahab. The man is with those whom he loves. This is a hadith. Anas bin Malik narrates that day when the Prophet said that, peace be upon him, it was one of the most festive days of the Sahaba because they knew who they loved. Al mar'u ma'a man ahab. The man is with the one that he loves. So Allah also told us to find these people. He said, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنِّي لَكُم مِّنْهُ نَذِيرٌ مُّبِينٌ. He said, run to Allah, Verily, I am to you from him an open warner. This is La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. That Allah commands us to get to him, but then he says, how? Inni lakum minhu nadhirun mubin, talking about the Prophet, peace be upon him. Verily, I am to you from him an open warner. But there are people who stand in the Prophet's capacity in that way. These are his inheritors. You find those people, that individual, he has found one of these kinds of people. And now he's learning how to be like him. And that individual shows him the secret of dhikr, how to make dhikr, to that point where he actually realizes God in this life. That's called ma'rifah. And then he realizes his sir, right? He realizes who it is that he is, and who Allah is. And he comes back home. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Verily we are to Allah. Verily we are from Allah and to him we... Actually, it actually says, verily we are from Allah and to him we are returning. That's what it actually means, by the way. It doesn't mean we are going to return. It means it's happening right now. Raji'un is not past tense or present tense. It's present tense. So, in a nutshell, I don't think it can be... that's why the Prophet, peace upon him, said, make dhikr until people think that you're crazy. In other words, don't be a person of this world. Mention Allah so much that people who are from this world will say that, you know, you're crazy. Until you become a full human being. Yeah.
I had a question. When you mentioned that we should do zikr, are you talking about any type of zikr?
Well, that's more specific. So,
what I'm wondering is, I've understood that if you want to do zikr, the best thing is first of all to establish the faraid and the sunnah.
Yeah, those are dhikr too. Waqim as-salat al-dhikri. That's all dhikr. My slave does not come to me by anything more beloved to me than that which I made obligatory upon him. Mimma fardtu alayh. And he does not, and he continues to draw closer to me by the involuntary acts. Hatta he continues to draw close to me by the involuntary actions until I love him. Right. So that's the way that you do it. The involuntary actions, in this sense, for example, is the dhikr of the tongue. If you never make dhikr of the tongue ever in your life, are you going to go to hell? No. If you never make dhikr with your limbs, in other words, you don't pray the salat, the obligatory dhikr, where you go to hell, you know, you have a pretty high chance of doing so. Right? So, it's all remembrance, but now we're talking about involuntary remembrance. And so it's not all the same. And even in involuntary remembrance, there's different types. The involuntary remembrance that you make, that for example, you go and you find something in the sunnah, and you just start doing that, like the dhikr after the prayers, for example. That's different than dhikr that's prescribed to you. It's different. And the dhikr how you get back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, literally, how you get into His presence is that you take dhikr that is prescribed to you from someone whom it was prescribed to. This is called idhn. And the proof of that is how is it? Adam called on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for some 300 years. Adam called on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for some 300 years on the earth. You know, he was sent down to India. And then from that point on, he was calling on Allah for 300 years until Allah gave him words to say. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمَ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلِيْهِ. It wasn't until Adam was given words to say that Allah turned towards him. That's called idhn. So there's dhikr that you can make that's from the sunnah, and there's dhikr that you make that comes by permission. The dhikr that comes by permission is what causes God to turn towards you. The dhikr that's from the sunnah, this dhikr that you do because it's God's right. But what God gives you to say, or in another way, what you are given to say by someone who's been given permission to say, is what causes Allah to turn towards you. That's from the Quran. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمَ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ.
But does that mean that you should, because you said earlier that once you're mature enough, you will be presented to that kind of person.
Yeah. Or not mature, if Allah graces you. If Allah graces you, yeah.
But if you know that these people maybe will be found in a specific geographic area, you yourself, we overheard Sheikh Hamza Yusuf when he went to Mauritania and the desert and all that, he actually sought out that place.
I mean, you understand my question? I mean,
absolutely. Yeah, you can go to the.
You seek that knowledge, or do you wait, sit in your home and do think of myself?
No, you do the necessary means, but you call on Allah and ask Him. You do the necessary means, but the whole time your heart is attached to Allah, knowing that if Allah wants to bring someone to your home, He will. If Allah wants to bring someone to your masjid, He will. Yeah, because Allah doesn't. Whatever good is written for us, we'll never miss it. So the reason why I said all of this to you as a group is because at times we need reminders to heighten our aspirations. Don't let dhikr become another idol. I make dhikr because I make dhikr. No, you make dhikr because it's Allah's right. But you want to realize the reality of dhikr, which is actually Allah. The reality of dhikr is Allah. We don't just make dhikr because it's a good thing to do, and so that we can have some kind of religious affiliation. I'm a Sufi or something like that. Like all of that stuff is just it's idolatry in a sense. That's not, none of that stuff's the point. None of that stuff is, Allah is the point. But where is Allah in my dhikr? And that's the irony. Like, where is Allah in my dhikr? Where is Allah in my dhikr? What's the relationship there? So this is a little bit of, like, I guess, kind of like nasiha or something like that. I keep saying that because I don't want to go too long.
Okay.
Yeah. Meaning, like, we can sit for hours if you want, but I'm not.
No, I just
lecturing or something like that.
I just have one last question. Regarding the nafs, what you mentioned, if I understood correctly, you mean the nafs go through different stages?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it does. Just like deen is different stages. Deen is different stages. Islam, Iman, Ihsan. The heart goes through different stages. The heart becomes a Muslim, the heart becomes a mu'min, and the heart becomes a muhsin. Deen is three things. The heart makes tawbah. I mean, the nafs makes tawbah. Then it has istiqamah. Then it has taqwa. Then it becomes a believer. As a believer, it has sidq. Then it attains ikhlas. And then it has tranquility. And then it goes into the state of ihsan. Allah gives him muraqabah. It's that, in other words, realizing that Allah is seeing him, and then it has, and he's watching himself. Then there's mushahada, the witnessing of God's presence, and then finally ma'rifah, and he becomes a muhsin. So there's nine mother stations, you can see, from Islam all the way to ihsan. The heart is going to go through different, or the soul, the person, is going to go through different stages until they become an arif Allah, someone who knows Allah. Yes.
Just one a bit more better. Yeah. So how do we know that we're on the right track? You mentioned that if we're starting to going away from, like, the guy who sold a restaurant,
yeah.
Those kind of things, make decisions that we think are for Allah, and maybe then we know that we're on the right path. You talk about the. Also, I want to know how can you feel that you are going towards Allah? Is it just by doing those things that happen, problems start happening to you?
No, like how do you know you're going towards Allah? Because you're remembering less and less of other things. Yeah, proximity is by virtue of preoccupation. The more and more you're preoccupied with Allah, the more and more He's preoccupied with you.
Okay.
So the more distant you become from this world, and
No. That's what I was saying before, that you have to have the world in order to understand the signs of Allah. Like an alam, like alama, ayn, lam, mim, is related to this word for sign, an alam. An alam is a world. So there's a sign, there's a relationship between the fact that this world is a sign. You have to use the world to understand God's signs. Getting close to Allah doesn't mean that you get far away from the world at all. It means that you actually use the world for what it's for. You get away from those things which is dunya, which is, in other words, like low and base. Dunya is from this word, like adna shay. The closest thing to us is called the dunya. That's why it's called dunya. It means close. So you, in other words, you're not just, you're not, the sign of one getting close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that they're not just looking at things as objects. They're realizing that each thing has a function. Each thing, what is its function? That you're seeing that these things are what causes me to know God. They're signs. For example, Allah is Al-Jamir. Allah is the one who gathers. We're having a gathering right now. He's Al-Jamir. That is his sign, and that is his name manifested. Al-Jamir. I wouldn't know that if I didn't have a jama'ah. If I didn't have a group, I wouldn't know that Allah is Al-Jamir. Allah is Al-Khaliq. He's the creator. We're all created things. If there wasn't for this world, I wouldn't know what Al-Khaliq means. I wouldn't know Allah in that way.
But Allah also mentions in the Quran that verily you prefer this world, even though you know that you are returning to me.
Yeah, hayat ad-dunya.
Yeah.
That's different though. The life of the world, the life of, in other words, the life of that thing which is the closest thing to you. In other words, the ajala. You just want everything to be instantly. This sensory realm. You're just pleased with what it looks like and what it tastes like. You don't look beyond that for what it means. That's the life of the world. The life of the world is a world of objectification. You don't. It's not a sign of God to you. And you just accumulate it for the sake of itself. You don't have it for the sake of getting close to Allah. That's the difference between the person of the world and the person of the hereafter. They're both in the same space, but one is seeing the world in an entirely different way. So in other words, this idea of like, you know, you just go off to a cave somewhere and no one sees you again. Nah, not like that. I mean, there are times for that. I mean, the khalwa, there's times for that. The Prophet ﷺ, that's how he got Nabuwah. But that's not, you know, that would be a misuse of the world that we live in.
But you, as you said, in your daily life, if you see that you're removing things that are dunya, and you're doing and replacing it with dhikr of some kind, that is a sign that you are drawing closer to.
Yeah, your life is becoming more and more meaningful, and Allah is the ultimate meaning. Yeah. In other words, the signs of you drawing close to Allah is that you have more and more dhikr from you and around you. You know, like you get agitated if you're not making dhikr, or if you're not hearing dhikr, you start to get agitated. That's the signs that you're drawing closer and closer and closer. Like for example, you know, like an example of that was when SubhanAllah, it's not coming to me. There's a Nabi that saw one of the wives of paradise, and it's not coming to me which one it was. SubhanAllah. It wasn't Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyway, he saw one of the wives of paradise. No. Sorry, it's a different story. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Musa, he heard Allah's speech, which has no sound. And when he came back from Mount Sinai, at first when he was around other people, the sounds of creation made him vomit. He couldn't handle the sound of it. It was so ugly compared to what he'd heard that it made him throw up. You know what I mean? So for him, like he had been exposed to what beauty is. And so for everything else, he was like, ah, you know, it's the same kind of it's the same kind of thing that when dhikr comes in your life, the things that are not beautiful like that start to become abhorrent to you. You know, like you start like kind of, you don't want to hang out and just, you know, shoot the breeze with people for very long. After a certain time, you're just like, you know, because you don't like it anymore. You know, you get your social quota, but then when you're done, you're just like, I gotta go. You know, and where you're gonna be found? You're gonna be reading Quran. You're gonna be making tasbih. Or some people, you know, one of the highest levels of dhikr isn't even saying, Allah, Allah, Allah. It's tafakkur, that you just sit at the edge of a lake and just contemplate God. That's one of the highest forms of dhikr, contemplation. Like, how many people even do that anymore? Yeah? Yeah, just sitting and thinking about Allah, like, how He is. You know, just that. That's one of the highest levels of dhikr. Because you're thinking about other things, it gives you anxiety, it makes you upset. You know, a person of Allah deals with the dunya as long as they have to. And then, you know, they take care of it. See, the thing is, if we didn't have this positive tension, if we didn't have dunya, there'd be nothing to drive us close to Allah. Think about that. So Sharia is there so that you have to engage and you have to do it in a certain way to create just enough tension to where you, when you're done, you go right back to Allah. Right? You have to take care of your responsibilities. Because if you don't have these things, in other words, opposites. Yeah. Jalal and Jamal. Might and beauty. You know, you can divide all of Allah's attributes into Jalal and Jamal. It's all still Allah. You're at work. Boss is breathing down your neck. There's 5 minutes left to go. It's Friday. He comes up and tells you he wants you to come in on Saturday. That's Allah's Jalal. It's still Allah. It's a Jalal because in your world, you don't like it. But that causes you to say what? Subhanallah. But you said Subhanallah in a way that was sincere. That's the Jamal that comes from it. Whereas if the guy hadn't come to you and hadn't told you you have to come in on Saturday, you would have been in ghafla. You'd be, you know, in heedlessness. It's 4 minutes left. You go to the internet on your computer in your little cubicle and you want to see what the football score is. Right? Yeah, right. But that moment when he came, it reminded you of Allah because you called on him. If you didn't have that difficulty, you wouldn't have said his name. If we didn't have any problems, we would just do whatever we, you know. It's being in the world and feeling distance from Allah that causes one to go to Allah. So, mashallah, man. That's why, at the end of the day, all you really can say, all you really can say, if you know what's going on, all you can really say is Alhamdulillah. And, you know, that's why they say, you know, Alhamdulillah is the first thing in Quran. And the rest of it is a tafsir. The first thing in Quran is Alhamdulillah, and everything unto An-Nas is a tafsir.
So what's your answer to your opening question then?
What was it? Who are you?
Yeah.
Sorry,
Mr.
No, what was his answer to his opening question?
No, but we answered it. We said you are your soul. But what is your soul? That's what the spiritual path is there to show you. Okay. So the question is something you can't, it's not a theoretical question, it's an applied question. Okay. It is answerable, but it's something that once you know it, you can't even express it. Wallahi, for example, everyone here, tell me, what does honey taste like?
Like honey.
No, man, don't do that. Okay, it tastes sweet. I had some chocolate over there, that was sweet. Is that what honey tastes like?
Not
quite. Alright, for forget about sweet, what does honey taste like?
Sugar.
Alright, sugar. Sugar cane tastes like sugar. Is that what honey tastes like? No. Not sweet, it's not sugary. What's the next one?
Lovely.
That's not a taste. That's not a taste. What does honey taste like?
If it tastes, it's experience.
That's the thing, man. Raise your hand in this room if you've never had honey before. Exactly. But none of us can describe it. It's an experience. It's a knowledge. That's true knowledge. True knowledge is, would you say that none of you have any knowledge about honey? You would all say, no, I'm absolutely sure what honey tastes like. I know for a fact. Right? Ana arif, yani, arif asal. Right? I know asal. Because why? Now notice that you would say ana arifu. You wouldn't say ana alamu. I know it. You say ana arifu. It's an intimate knowledge that you have. It's based on experience. So in order for you and I to know who we are, it has to come from experience. Someone tells you about who you are. That's
We are created by God.
Yes.
If I think about who I am, yeah. I think I'm created by God.
Absolutely.
That's how I think. If one person is a criminal or he makes a lot of prayer, he's automatically created by God.
Absolutely.
He's not a criminal created to be a criminal.
No.
This is a choice he made.
Mm-hmm. You're saying like كل الأشياء مخلوق. Everything is created. That's what you are, your creation.
Yeah.
But that's true, but the thing is, so the problem with that is that this is created, yes?
Yes.
I'm created, right? Then what is the difference between me and this thing?
You have a soul.
That's what we're talking about. Yeah. So yes, in a way, yes, we are created, but there's something definitely different about me and this microphone. I mean, absolutely. You know, and that difference makes me specifically, it identifies who I am. Makes me different than the microphone. If I didn't have a soul, I would be the same as the microphone. That's why when people die, they're just like objects. You just put them in the ground and remember who was there at one time. So the spiritual path, that's why they say, and I haven't found evidence that this is a hadith, but it's still true. You know, man arafa nafsuhu arafa rabbah. Whoever knows themselves knows their Lord. You know, they call that a hadith, but Allahu a'lam. But it is true. Whatever it is true. And it's something that the people of Allah have been saying for a long time. Whoever knows themselves knows their Lord. You cannot know Allah through anything but who you are. But who you are is your soul. So you have to know your soul. You can't know your soul until you remember. You can't know your soul until you remember what it is and remember who you are. That's what the spiritual paths are for. It's a lot different than just opening up, like Haseen. You know, it's a lot different than opening up a book of du'as and just, you know, it's a lot different than that. People confuse things.
But these are confused times. I mean,
absolutely.
Even the guy who sold the restaurant juice, he could just as likewise have go to the masjid and do all other things. That is, he's not going the spiritual path. He's maybe going the physical path.
Yeah.
In Islamic, you understand what I'm saying? Mm. These are confusing times. Different. Even within Islam, there are different. come here. So it's very confusing.
Yeah.
If you don't have knowledge, I mean, ultimately it's Allah who is guiding you. But
yeah.
It's really confusing times.
Mm. But if Allah wants good for a slave, they'll know exactly what they want. They'll know exactly what they want. You know, confusing times, sure. Someone who's born as a Muslim, living as a Muslim, amongst Muslims, in a Muslim community or in the Muslim world, that's confusing. What about someone who's born in a non-Muslim family, never heard of Islam, doesn't even know what Allah is? How more confusing is that? Like, that was me. When I was 6 years old, I asked my dad what God's name was. He didn't know. So talk about confusing times.
But I'm talking about, you could still have been that guy who embraced Islam and propagated another type of Islam.
That's, yeah,
maybe more hardline than,
yeah, yeah,
you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So,
but the difference is, I think the difference is that I became Muslim for a reason. إنما الأعمال بالنيات. Actions are about by intention. And I'm not saying that this is because of my intention.
No.
But I can say that on my own behalf that I became Muslim for a reason. I wanted to know God. That's the reason. Because Allah hates shirk. You know, at the end of the day, this is what we're trying to do. We're trying to get rid of shirk. That's what Islam is about. And I wanted to know God, and I was completely, I kind of relate to Musa. That something happened in their life where the notion of living in a world that's just for creation, for creation's purpose, made me feel spiritually ill. And I couldn't handle it anymore. So I was looking for that. What is that way that is going to be absolutely free of these obstacles? I don't want to worship a guru. I don't want to, you know, I want God himself. You know, where is it? So it is confusing times, but the onus is on the person. Yeah, you look, this deen is about Adam al-Shirk. This deen is about the absence of polytheism. And sometimes it's very subtle. أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهُ هَوَاهُ. Have you seen the one who's taken himself as his Lord? Your own self can become an idol. Even though your name is Muhammad or Abdullah. Your own self can become an idol because you're just worshipping yourself. Allah's got nothing to do with it. Shirk is serious. Shirk is not, you know, you don't just read some treatise on Aqidah and now, mashallah, you're shirk free. It's much more complicated than that.
But even when you said about the dhikr session that we have, I mean, just doing dhikr for dhikr in itself, that's one kind of...
It's shirk. It's shirk. That is also shirk.
Yeah.
In other words, we can't be free from shirk until we go home. You can't be free from shirk until we go home. And how do you get home? You do dhikr with a specific niyyah, with a specific permission to know Allah. Until that time, come in ladyan. How many deens are there out there?
Yeah. Billions.
How many worlds are there? Allah said he's Lord of the worlds. The world is how I perceive it. I mean, that's fascinating. You know, when I opened the Quran, I was fascinated. The first time I opened the Quran, it said, "All praise is due to God, Lord of the worlds." First thing I thought was, yeah, all praise is due to God. I was like, yeah, that is true, though. You know, I was like, yeah, that's pretty much true. Then it said, Lord of the worlds. I was like, good God, how many worlds are there? I really didn't. And then I thought to myself, this is not from people. Like, humans don't think like this. Humans don't say, a human being is not going to say all praises are due to God, Lord of the worlds. Humans don't even, that's not even our domain to think like that. We're not going to say that. Yeah. And then I was so impressed by how personal the Quran was. My favorite hadith are the hadith Qudsiyah, because God has a tendency to speak in first person in those. I love those. You know, like, Ana inda dhanni abdi bi, I'm to my slave as he thinks of me. Ooh. You know, wa ana ma'ahu idha dhakarani, and I am with him if he remembers me, or when he remembers me. That makes my hair stand up. In the Quran, when he was saying, like, in the Quran, when it's first person, I started reading that, I was like, me? You know, oh my slave. You know, oh my slave. Do not despair in the mercy of Allah. Ya ibadi, oh my slaves. I'm like, because you know you own me. And you're talking to me like this, and you're giving me advice. Don't despair on the mercy of Allah. Like, that was like, you know, you're realizing that you want God alone. And then you're finding a book that is talking to you from the perspective of God alone, to someone who wants God alone.
Perfect match.
Yeah, match made in heaven.
Yeah, exactly.
But we're all like that. Wallahi, we're all like that. But we just don't, like the example with the water, we're all like that. Remember the water in the cup? We're all like that, but some of us have forgotten how things work. Our aql is gone. We don't know the nature of how things work. But as soon as we hear it, we can, oh, okay. It's a realignment. You know, Bashira Munadira, the Prophet ﷺ was a giver of glad tidings and a warner. But he just brought us this whole thing. Basically.